Someone in the crowd, the only thing you really see. Watching while the world keeps spinning round. Somewhere there's a place where I find who I'm gonna be. A somewhere that's just waiting to be found.
Welcome to the movie podcast.
My name is
Daniel. Oh my god.
Welcome to this bonus episode.
I'm so sorry for whoever's listening to this.
I said
right
Chupu.
Now.
Chupu.
Chupu. Who's
yeah,
Chupu?
Yeah, because it was just a bunch of gibberish, so I thought I would get in some weird words.
Are
in
you
there.
Telling us to chew poo?
Nope.
Okay, well, I'm just making sure. Just
Chupu.
I don't want to do that.
This is a very special episode that has no place in time. But it's
no time and place.
But it's oddly
relevant.
Relevant to time.
And place.
And place. This episode is
sponsored by
this episode is all about our top movies of the decade.
This is a big one.
So
this is
our
a big disgusting episode.
Disgusting episode?
How big it is.
It's gonna get messy for sure.
Yeah. It's gonna be controversial.
Why?
Every episode with me is going to be controversial.
My gosh.
I'm going to make it happen.
This is like 36 episodes
it
now.
It is. But yeah, so this episode, we will be going round robin. Each of us will go around the table and list a favorite movie of the decade starting in 2010. Mm-hmm. So we'll go from 2010.
Do I get to start?
Yeah, you can start. Going from 2010 to 2019, we will go around the table, each giving a movie, why we like it, have a mini discussion, and then continue on from there.
And it's our personal film from that year.
Right.
Like, it's the movie that we're like, okay, I can watch this over and over again. Yeah. And
or this is what, this is what, when
this
I think
is
of 2010,
what I, yeah, when I think of 2010, this is what I think of. Right. Yeah. Yeah, this is a nice little bonus episode that we have here for this day that you're listening to it on.
Shay and I are currently in Florida as you're listening to this.
In sunny Orlando.
I'm not in Florida.
Anthony is not. He's in the snow right now.
Thank God.
But the nice thing about this is, if some massive news does break, which it probably will when we don't have access to our microphones.
Always. We're going to fly in.
We'll fly in.
Well, you're going to be in Florida, so you know there's going to be some massive news that's happening there.
So we'll find a way to convey it to you. But I think without further ado, let's just dive into our list. Starting with 2010, the year 2010. Anthony, kick us off with your
Toy Story 3.
Why?
Why?
It's a Toy Story 3. Like, what? Why not?
Well, give us more. Like,
okay,
why?
It's Toy Story 3.
Yeah.
I said it three times right now.
Right.
Yeah, so three times Toy Story.
It's a rule
is,
of three.
The end of the Toy Story 3, or Toy Story arc, we'll say, with Andy. Phenomenal movie. Great story. Very tense moments. A lot of crying moments.
And I will say, it's one of the only animated movies, because I feel like we've all grown up with Toy Story.
Yeah.
That, because Andy was going off to college, I was going off to university that year. Like, it was one of those things where it's like, it felt so like connected to who I was, because you like, you feel like those toys are part of your identity, right?
Right, right, right.
And I just remember bawling my eyes out of that movie too.
Yeah, it was very emotional for me, just because I grew up with Toy Story. I went to go watch Toy Story 1 in the theaters, 2 and 3. No, wait, I didn't go watch 2 in theaters.
How dare you?
Oh, yeah, I did. And then 3. And then, yes, you're right. The whole, like, the grown-up Andy. I was like, oh, he's grown up. He's leaving his toys. Just that a well-written story. Very, very passionate.
That incinerator scene definitely
got unreal. That was unreal.
They went there with that. And I think, too, with Toy Story 3, not a lot of animated films show the progression of time, right? So to see the fact that we're going into Toy Story 3 and like Andy's older, you're just like, oh, whoa. Like,
it's mature.
This is
it's
more
not
mature,
playing with
right?
toys anymore. You know what I mean? Like,
so you're dealing with a thing that's really has the issues on it.
How about you?
My 2010. So I had Toy Story 3 on there. 2010 is such a difficult year.
Very tough year for me.
Because
as well.
It's had such banger movies that bangers. I still watch to this day.
Let's hear them.
Man. It's so hard, man. There's. I'm going to go with the movie. Probably the most popular movie of 2010 was Inception. Mm-hmm. And it's a movie that I think people knew who Christopher Nolan was because of the Dark Knight movie, but I feel like Inception is what made Christopher Nolan a director that everybody would pay attention to.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm gonna stick with my gut, and I'm going to go with Inception because that's a phenomenal movie from every aspect of the plot. That it's part of pop culture now with like a dream within a dream type scenario. It's just a reference so much. The score I still listen to.
Hans Zimmer, man.
It's just a phenomenal movie, but 2010 probably has four of my favorite movies of all time on that.
Oh, yeah.
Of that year.
Yeah.
And I know you're going to say one of them now.
I know you guys are going to say it.
I'll let you say the next one because I have a feeling what you're going to choose.
Why don't you just play the theme song?
I don't know what he thinks we're going to play right now.
If you don't say it, then I'm gonna like.
I know what you know. I'm gonna say, and that's the worst part about it. So the thing is, I put two down here, but obviously I'm only saying the one.
Yeah,
but we can acknowledge the other one.
Right.
The one that I put down to me is a film that was unexpected for 2010.
Yeah.
It was really what opened up my eyes to this director.
Yeah.
And that movie is The Social Network.
Yep. I knew it. I knew it.
The song.
Ba-ding. Is that the part? Like, what song?
That sounds like a Chinese guitar. I don't know what that was.
Like a mandolin?
Mandolin's a Chinese guitar.
What is it then?
It's an Italian guitar. Yeah.
Oh, sorry. I thought you hate Italians.
No, I'm wearing a plumber on my shirt.
Here.
Oh, Anthony does, yeah.
He hates that guy.
But yeah, Social Network. Why did you choose Social Network over The Town? That's why I wanted.
So I put The Town down as well. Yeah. And the reason why is The Town was a film that I didn't watch in 2010.
You did not watch it in 2010. No.
Wow.
I watched it probably a year or two
technicality,
after.
Yeah.
And it's not so much that. But I get what you're saying, too. It's more so that Social Network, it did a lot. And it's still super relevant today as well.
Right.
It's not a movie that I've watched as much as I've watched The Town, because I've watched The Town a lot.
Right.
But Social Network really took an idea and something that was as boring or simple as Facebook.
The Facebook movie.
Yeah.
When
that
it was
we kept hearing about.
When we saw the trailers, they're like, they're really making a movie about Facebook?
Like, fuck this.
Like, why would you do that?
Yeah.
And it turned out to be.
And one hearing of the that best David Fincher was attached to it, and you're like, well, okay, well, that guy made one of my favorite films, Seven. Sure, whatever. Let's see what happens.
Anthony, have you finished The Social Network yet?
No.
You have not finished it yet. So we have to watch it, the three of us, one day.
No, I haven't not.
On my 2010 list, literally, is Inception, Social Network, Toy Story 3, and The Town.
Yeah,
same And here. I put honorable mention maybe to The Fighter. I really liked The Fighter that year.
It's a good movie.
Really good movie. I wouldn't put it in the league with those other ones.
It's not genre-defining at all.
Yeah, 2010 was a great year for movies.
Solid year.
Solid year for movies. 2011, Anthony, I'm going to tee it up to you for your next one.
We'll keep it like this, yeah.
Drive.
Ooh, Drive. Good choice.
Also on my list as well, too, for that
also
year.
Also on my list as well.
What about Drive made it so...
It was an unexected movie.
Yeah.
It was unexpected. When I went into it, I didn't know what to expect. I didn't even know Ryan Gosling wasn't going to talk in this film. The whole sequence, the whole setup for this movie was amazing.
Right.
I just love the tone. I love the direction. I love the pacing. I love that how it had almost like this comic book noir vibe to it. That again, I wasn't expecting.
Yeah.
It's
funny with Drive. Drive is like one of the biggest like indie movies that I see people like when people think of indie movies. I feel like Drive is one of those movies that always kind of comes
and one
up.
Of the most like misleading trailers.
Yeah, and that's it. It was marketed almost like an action film, and it's not that.
The
it's
soundtrack
much a slow
was
burn.
Phenomenal,
mm-hmm. and I always the soundtrack is what comes to mind.
But
for
what
that movie.
Kind of gets me is like it's a Nicholas.
Winding Refn
film, and he never ever lived up to anything else after film.
Drive, yeah.
Nothing.
His art direction was phenomenal.
Yeah.
The colors were great. Those
driving scenes, man. Everybody
the
wanted
beginning
to copy
driving
that,
sequence
you know?
Where it's just like you see, you know,
that bank, that
Ryan Gosling seeing? Looking through the mirror,
yeah.
The rearview mirror. It's just like. The shadows, the lights, L.A. It's like
tells
very
the,
Los Angeles,
yeah.
Which I really love.
He tells you the rules of the movie right in the first
yeah.
The first bit of exposition. Is like, if you're here in 5 minutes or whatever, I'm your guy. And then for the next 5 minutes, I'm your guy. Anything after that, like, you're on your own type deal. Like, it's perfect.
And it's that perfect sequence, setup. That one part where Ryan Gosling...
At the pawn shop?
Is it at the pawn shop or at the bar?
Oh, with
at the bar.
Where Oscar Isaac?
Oh, where the guy sits down beside him?
Sits down. He's like, yeah, I know you. I know. Like, you
shut your mouth. I'll kick your teeth down.
Yeah. And it's like, fuck. That's cool. I wish they made like a sequel. I wanted to know more about where he came from.
But I almost kind of wish they... I'm glad
they didn't. Yeah, and they didn't. And that's great. But yeah, the elevator scene, ultra violent take is just so good.
And phenomenal movie. And Al Brooks is that unlikely villain.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you Mel Brooks.
And no. Albert Brooks.
Oh, so Albert.
Mel Brooks.
Yeah, not Mel Brooks.
Is his brother, right?
No, I think that's a comedian.
Because yeah, the Mel Brooks movies, yeah. No, but I was going to say, like, great casting. You have Bryan Cranston in that. You have Ryan Gosling. You have Michelle Williams.
Oscar Isaac
is in it. Like, you have a really good cast in this movie, and I just... They're all actors that are doing really well today, and I think when you look back at that movie, I think for Ryan Gosling especially, that really helped define his career as well, too. 2011 for me, again, I have Drive on there. I have Moneyball on there as well, too. I don't know why. I'm not a baseball person, but there's something about Moneyball.
It's a great movie, though. That's Sorkin, right?
Sorkin writing. It just gets me. And Dragon Tattoo is on my list as well, too, for that year. But for the movie for 2011 for me, I'm going to say Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol. And I remember going to watch that movie three times in theaters in the December it came out. I went with my dad three times to watch it because we loved it so much. We loved the Dubai scene with the Burj Khalifa and him running across there. Shay, you've been to Dubai, right?
Gang, gang.
Sandstorms are exactly how they are in that movie, right?
It was such a realistic... It brought me back to my childhood.
Sandstorms of growing up, right?
I thought you were going to say sand people for a second.
No, that's racist.
Is it?
Jawas.
Yeah, it's Jawas. No, sad people are the...
Immediate offense to that, so we'll have words after this podcast.
But yeah, with Ghost Protocol, though, in 2011, also attached to it, like, the Dark Knight Rises prologue was attached to it, so I also have the memories
of going
to go see, like, that opening sequence with Bane ripping a plane.
Yeah, yeah.
Crashing this plane!
I totally forgot about that sequence.
And, like, I just have such fond memories, but, like, just Mission Impossible, Ghost Protocol, I think... was a turning point for that series when it comes to just making it go big and better.
Brad Bird.
His first live action movie.
Best live action movie.
And his best live action movie. I can't say enough good things about that movie, and it's a movie that I watch a couple times a year still to this day. I just saw it at the Cinesphere in Ontario Place. Just in August, seeing that on the IMAX screen, and it just... a phenomenal movie. Shay.
So, yes, I mean, obviously, you've got Mission Impossible, Ghost Protocol, and that was a huge film as well that year. I agree with you 100%.
Yeah, made a lot of money, too.
Made a lot of money, really defined the genre as it is now, and just kickstarted this new franchise almost in a way. I'm going to be giving it to a film that I had absolutely zero expectations for, had zero hope in. And it completely surprised me. And unfortunately, it was just that one film and nothing else after it really stood out. And that's X-Men First Class.
Yes, for sure.
Matthew Vaughn came out of nowhere, really.
That was the movie that nobody was looking forward to that year.
No one.
That was the year
awful marketing. Awful posters.
Most marketing the worst still. Posters ever. And like it was so rushed as well.
Yeah. And nothing about that film was like, okay, this is going to be good. And the casting felt weird too.
Yeah, very strange cast.
But it has some of the most memorable scores that I can remember.
Henry Jackman,
Frankenstein's like that theme for Magneto.
Bum bum, bum bum, bum bum, bum bum.
And the opening scene I remember shook me when you see Kevin Bacon and young Magneto.
Yeah.
And it just cuts, and you just see that room full of torture weapons.
And people know we have a soft spot for World War II.
We do have a soft spot for World War II. And it just, that to me, I mean, granted, the film has its moments and flaws in here
for sure,
and there.
Yeah.
But overall, what it was trying to do, I loved.
I'm 100% with you. And when you're thinking about 2011, that's the year that I graduated. So I remember just always going to the movies with my friends. And like that was the year that Thor came out, Captain America, Green Lantern. So like those were like the big ones people were looking for, and Thor and Captain America delivered. Green Lantern did not, obviously. Nope. But I remember us watching First Class, and especially after studying Frankenstein, and that scene with Michael Fassbender in the bar.
I'm Frankenstein's monster.
I'm looking for my creator.
Yeah.
One of the greatest scenes of the decade, hands down. And And I just wish that the X-Men movies going forward were able to capture that magic that was there. Because I think if had Matthew Vaughn returned, the X-Men universe would be looking very differently today. Mm-hmm. And who knows how that would have affected the Disney buyout as a whole, right?
I agree.
Yeah.
2012. Anthony.
The year that the Mayans predicted wouldn't have, you know, gone further.
Is that the year that we were supposed to all die like, and melt or something?
Yeah, we were supposed to die that year.
Yeah.
We survived.
But you know who didn't die?
Tell me about this.
The Avengers. Dun, 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 dun. So yeah, I'm pretty sure this was on your list.
Yeah.
No, you guys,
not at all.
This was totally on my list.
Yeah.
Wow. This was the first time ever that they did a superhero team-up film right. And this was like the only time ever, but they did it really good.
It shouldn't have worked.
Yeah.
It should not have worked.
There were too many odds against it.
When you saw like the whole, like with the whole Paramount Disney weirdness going on with Disney buying Marvel, and the fact that like Iron Man 2 was fine, Captain America was like fine, Thor was fine, like they weren't beloved yet by the populace.
It wasn't there yet.
It wasn't there. Like they were all good entries, but it wasn't like they weren't embedded like they are. Like when you think about Endgame where it is now, like into where it started, the Avengers is a huge gamble. And it's my number one too for that year, because I don't think you could look at 2012
without
seeing Avengers and what that did and how much box office records it broke and everything like that too, right?
Do you have an alternate though if you didn't have Avengers on there?
I think Dark Knight Rises is up there too, just for how like it ending the Nolan trilogy.
That trilogy.
Django was a phenomenal movie, and it's one of those movies that I absolutely love. Same with Argo as well. And also, if I'm looking at a smaller movie, 21 Jump Street.
That was actually mine, yeah.
Yeah,
I'll let that you was, talk that about was it. That was my number one pick, because obviously I knew Avengers would be on there, Argo. You have Skyfall in there too, which a lot of people enjoy.
Yeah, that was on my
Silver Linings Playbook.
Yeah, it was
I find myself watching that film quite a bit.
Oh, really?
I don't know why. It's a really never great
seen
film.
It. Oh, you've never seen it, eh?
Never seen it. It's really well written, really like well directed.
I think I own it though.
It's very interesting.
It's funny because like The Fighter was on my 2010 list, and the same director.
Yeah.
For.
David.
Why am I blanking on Damon, his name right now?
David O. Russell.
David O. Russell, yeah. I was blanking on his name.
But every time I pass by it or it's on Netflix, I'll watch it.
Yeah.
It's just a well
I'm going to watch it soon.
Movie.
I'm
going to
watch it
soon. I really enjoy it. It's a really good. It's a really, really well-made movie.
Yeah, mine was Lincoln.
Oh, God.
Ooh.
Good God. No, never Lincoln.
But yeah, why Jump Street, Shay?
21 Jump Street because it's, again, very similar to X-Men. Everything is against it.
Yeah.
You have Jonah Hill and Channing Tatum.
In 2012.
Channing Tatum still not very well liked yet.
No.
Like, he's just that pretty boy dumbass.
And Jonah Hill is super bad.
Yeah.
You know?
And then you've got these directors from How Do the Chance of Meatballs coming to direct this film. And you're like, okay, who are these guys? It's
their first live action movie, right?
First live action film. Who are these guys? They're reviving a 80s television show here. Why should this be good?
What the fuck do they say about covalent bonds in this school? You know what I mean? Like,
this had no right to be this good.
No.
It is by far one of the funniest films. To this day, I still laugh as hard as I did when I watched it the first time.
Yeah.
It is so self-aware, so meta. And the fact that it was followed up by a brilliant sequel. The sequel is as good as the original. Yeah. I can watch them back to back.
Yeah. It's a phenomenal movie. And if you haven't watched 21 Jump Street by this point, watch it. Because it's just a phenomenal movie.
Have you watched it?
Yes.
You like
it?
Yes,
I have. Yes.
Yeah. Great, great movies. And just Phil, I think that's the movie that really put Phil Lord and Chris Miller on the map.
Oh, yeah.
Everyone in Hollywood.
Yeah. Cloud Atlas, too. And no, I'm just kidding.
God. 2013, Anthony.
Prisoners.
Ah, yes.
Good choice.
The reason why I chose Prisoners was it was my introduction to Denis Villeneuve.
Yep.
Denis. Français.
As a filmmaker. Again, it's something I didn't expect. I remember watching it in theaters, and I just felt the amount of
anxiety
and pressure, intense feeling that, oh my God, is he, who, where is this kid? What's happening?
You know,
what's going on? Oh my God. I hope they find him at the end. It's just,
But not what's so going on, good. Like, you don't understand. No, it. Just, no, like, what's no. going on, like, how is this going
to happen? No, but it was, like, yeah. Like,
why, is he, why, are they still, why do they still have Paul Dano? Like, why yeah. is he not telling them what this kid is?
Right.
Hugh Jackman.
What a movie.
Jake Gyllenhaal, I thought, was the
stand-up performance?
Stand-up performance.
I thought it was Hugh Jackman, because he was so angry.
Grizzly yeah. in that movie.
Like, when he, yeah. that scene when he's... When he's got Paul Dano up against the wall with Terrence Howard right beside him, and he's holding that hammer, and then he just breaks the sink.
Yeah,
like, I felt that scene.
When he beats the shit out of him in the bathroom.
Yeah,
yeah.
He turns the hot water on, the cold water on.
Jake Gyllenhaal, though,
he's amazing.
That so amazing. Ending sequence, that was a good year for Jake. Eyes. Yeah, the yeah. blood. Yeah, like he had that.
He got shot.
The slick black hair. Yeah. He's
Detective Loki was his name.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Weird. And I thought he was like, it must be this guy. He must
something's up with
him. Yeah, something's up with him. But yeah, such a beautifully a made movie.
Very, I couldn't agree with you more.
Yep.
Daniel.
Oh, man. 2013.
Very good year.
We had some great movies. We had some hits this year as well, too. Honorable mention I want to throw out to Gravity.
Mm.
Just that was that, our... That was our first kind of like hanging out.
That was my
out
first moment. Time ever becoming friends with Daniel.
We were friends, man, but we just...
I don't know why you keep saying that. I didn't think of you as a friend until Gravity. Gravity entered, and I'm like, I think I like this guy.
I really liked Inside Llewyn Davis that year as well, too. Mm-hmm. But I think... And Man of Steel, of course, as well, too. Beautiful film. But I'm going to give it to Wolf of Wall Street that year for me. Only because I've never done cocaine.
Mm-hmm.
But after that movie, I feel like I've done all the cocaine I'll ever need to do.
You've done lewds pretty much of that film.
Oh, yeah. The Quaaludes, like... That, Wolf of Wall Street is a movie that it blows me away that it exists. It's just one of those films that it's so excessive.
Yeah.
For the point of it being excessive.
It feels so weird. It's a Martin Scorsese film.
Right. But it also has the Martin Scorsese isms, and Leo's performance to this day is the best performance he's ever given in a movie. Period.
I agree. Not the Revenant.
Revenant. No,
not at all.
The Revenant is
forgettable.
Scent of a Woman with Al Pacino winning. Like that's it's the makeup. It's like it's them being like, let's give it to Leo for acting. But
I thought his best performance was Aviator.
Okay. Aviator was great.
Aviator was good, but he like the movie wasn't so strong.
He like Wolf of Wall Street was a movie that you just it was a that's a that is a that is a theme park movie. Mm-hmm. That is movie's a roller coaster.
Yeah,
it's absolutely phenomenal. And I think
that year we got two Leo films, eh? We got Great Gatsby that year too.
Oh yeah, we did got Gatsby in May. Common. Yeah, no, not at all.
You don't like Leo is so picky and takes so much time with his films that you don't really see two come out of one year.
But yeah, I'm gonna throw my
your hat
my hat in the ring for Wolf of Wall Street that year. Nice. How about you, Shay?
So my number one was also Prisoners as well. If I had to pick some alternates, Man of Steel really is up there. I know that that's a controversial one because people really seem to hate it, and that's fine. You can have your opinion on that. Another one that really stood out to me was Fruitvale Station, actually.
Oh, yeah.
Very, very good movie. Not one that I can kind of watch all the time.
Right.
But it's such a compact film in the way that it just gives you the story that you need to know. It gives you these performances that you need to see and a story that needs to be heard.
I mean, Ryan Coogler, that's really the film that
that's
introduced him to the world. Yep. And I remember when I saw that in theaters, everyone in the theater was crying.
Yeah.
That was such a tough watching them in the theaters and just everyone just kind of looking at each other, like leaving the theater and just feeling like so heavy after it. What a beautiful movie. And again, if you haven't watched Fruitvale Station, find where it's on whatever streaming service.
I think it's on Disney Plus.
Watch it because it's one of those need to watch.
I agree.
Need to watch it. 2014. This was a big year as well too for movies.
2014.
Where are you going with 2014, Anthony?
I'm spinning my dial. Oh shit! Where am I? 2014. I'm gonna go with. And this is because, again, it's just how storytelling can be shown through, you know, film and set design and all that. The Grand Budapest Hotel.
Oh, great Very choice. Good choice. Great choice.
Again, the reason why I picked this movie is just art design.
Yeah.
How everything is built for this movie.
And the aspect the ratio costume, as well, too.
The aspect ratio, the colors, the setup, the frame. It's just so beautifully shot. And it just, I always go to it because it's this weird, it almost feels like a Lego movie with real people.
Oh, yeah. That came out that year.
That the same year, yeah.
Yeah.
Did it? Yeah, it did. Oh, wow. Wes Anderson has a very distinct style, yeah. And I think that movie puts it on display so well.
Yeah.
And there's, again, great performances all around, and it's just...
Amazing cast. Ralph Fiennes, William Dafoe, Adrian Brody.
Thompson. The kid who plays Flash Thompson.
The kid who plays Flash Thompson? Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah, sorry. The bellboy. Yeah, he plays Zero, yeah.
Zero. I never remember his name.
Ricardo,
he's from Guatemala. I don't know how I know that.
But Saoirse Ronan, isn't it?
Saoirse Ronan.
Adrian Brody.
Yes, I already said
Jeff Goldblum.
Jeff Goldblum, yeah. Did you say I didn't? I wasn't listening to you, that's why. yeah, again, but it's Wes Anderson, so like his movies are always stacked with like a million people in it. But they're also used so well, right?
Yes.
Ed Norton, did you say Ed Norton as well, too? He's in it?
I didn't get to say it.
Because you interrupted him.
Yeah. Oh, really? We stopped talking, so.
Yeah, but you interrupted him.
I have long pauses.
I interrupted his pause, right?
Before I say something. I'm not Daniel.
You think before you
sure?
speak?
Are you?
You don't even
spontaneous.
I'm Daniel. I'm Shay. I'm controversial.
Is that I hate this race. Whoa, Anthony.
Anthony.
I never said that.
You might as well have.
Wow.
But yeah,
now your sand people are coming out.
Whoa, oh. There we go. Ayo.
2014 was a hard one. I mean, Grand Budapest.
A lot of bangers this year. This is a tough year for me to
Lego
pick.
Lego movie.
Well. I think I know
Soldier,
where you're going to pick. But
Gone Girl, Edge of Tomorrow, Whiplash, Dawn of the Planet of the Apes.
Why are you saying all the films, man?
Nightcrawler and Interstellar and Guardians of the Galaxy.
Why are you saying all the films?
Because those are literally what I have written for this movie. Because for this
what is,
year.
What is that? What is the one, though? You got to pick the one. You can't give away all our films.
I'm going to go with 2014. Whiplash. With a close... It's neck and neck with Winter Soldier.
Mm.
This is the W movies that year. But I'm going to talk about Whiplash just because Damien Chazelle, with that movie, that's a movie that I'll never forget watching it in theaters.
Yep.
Because that movie...
Literally gave me Whiplash.
That movie is the definition of anxiety. Mm-hmm. That just ever-present feeling of something wrong, that movie embodies that, and it's a movie that I love so much, and I've only watched it a couple times at home, and I love watching with people who haven't seen it, because that's a perfect movie for that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But what a ride that movie is.
It's a very digestible film.
And Miles Teller in that movie is amazing, and J.K. Simmons getting his Oscar for that movie is just...
Paul Reiner?
Amazing. Yeah. Amazing. And I think it's one of the best endings of a movie... For me, ever, period.
Like, cut to black, and then...
Cut to black. It's like, you understand exactly what happened between those two in that moment. Because there's a lot of people who I remember talking to, like, well, I didn't get the ending. I'm like, it's literally him becoming who he need to be because of his teacher being the asshole and J.K. Simmons seeing that.
It was them finally meeting.
And them understanding each other, right? Mm-hmm. And just, like, kind of that nod. And oh man, it's just unreal. What a movie. What a movie. That's a ride. But yeah, Winter Soldier, I can't say enough good things about because I love it so much.
Yeah, Whiplash was also my number one. I remember it was December, I believe.
December release, yeah.
Yes, and it was only playing in one theater in Toronto, and it was a theater I had never gone to.
Yeah. It was a Cineplex, though, right?
It was a Cineplex that I had never been to in my life. It looked like it was from the 80s, and I went by myself. This is one of the first few films I went to go see by myself. And I'm so glad no one else was there with me that knew me, because I was just panicking. I was holding onto the armrest, edge of my seat. It is a film that is so amazing, and I'm so glad Damien Chazelle has a career from it, because it's absolutely phenomenal. But yes, that year has Gone Girl. I mean, I know that Anthony, you're not a big fan of that film, but I love David Fincher. Yeah. I love Rosamund Pike. Also, that's the year that we got Dawn of the Planet of the Apes. That film, Matt Reeves, amazing. He revived a franchise that... wasn't even that bad to begin with. I mean, it was Rise of the Planet of the Apes was a decent film.
Yeah, it was a decent film.
But you did not expect it to go this way.
And then Dawn just took it to another level, right? And that's another, I think it's like top three that year.
I agree. Right? We got Nightcrawler that year too, which is amazing performances by Jake Gyllenhaal and Riz Ahmed. Yeah. One of the biggest surprises that year for me, though, was Edge of Tomorrow.
Amazing movie.
Doug Liman, written also by, I think, Chris McCrory.
Yep.
What a phenomenal film. Emily Blunt, Tom Cruise, they did such a great job in that movie.
Yeah. And then shout out to Interstellar that year as well, too. Like,
of course. And Winter Soldier, of course.
Winter Soldier, of course.
Or Jump Street.
You know, like...
Imitation Game.
Like, 2014 was a great year of movies. And it's crazy to think 2014 was 5 years ago.
Crazy.
That's insane.
One of our first movies together came out in 2014.
Days of Future Past.
X-Men Days of Future Past.
Was that the first time that the three of us released on a movie together?
I think so.
I would say so. From all the films that we've seen.
Did you see Kingsman with us, though? I think you saw Kingsman with us.
What year was that?
2015?
Oh, yeah, so it was the next year, so don't worry about me. Yeah, 2014. Days of Future Past, yeah. Wow.
Yeah. I remember that. I remember when we went to go see we all watched Queensway.
It. Yeah.
2015.
Yeah. 2015. Mm-hmm. I'm going to steal it.
Well, you're next, so you could take it.
I'm
going to
steal
it. Say it! So we could all discuss it together.
Sicario.
Okay, yeah, Sicario too. Okay, good.
Show me Sicario!
They got Dragon!
What can we say about Sicario on the show that we haven't already?
I don't know.
Wait, have you spoken to Sicario on the show? I think we haven't really.
So the story. Let's talk about the story of Sicario.
Well, let's talk about how we watched Sicario. So yes. Sicario, Dan and I watched together based on your recommendation.
Yes.
Yes.
So we had heard it was good.
Yeah.
But then you're like, no. You guys need to go watch this movie, especially for this border scene. Yep. And we did, but go on.
Yeah, so that's the story.
That was it.
I told you guys to watch the film, though. Again, it's Denis Villeneuve at his best. Intense moments, crazy cinematography, which was
Deakins.
the border sequence was probably the most anxiety I've ever had in a film.
Yeah. I mean,
I know, like, yes, Whiplash and all that, but like, this was
within this
like,
movie,
it felt so real. Yeah. It just felt like, man, this is gonna happen. When they
no one felt safe, that's why. And that sequence, no one felt safe.
We actually spoke about Sicario last week with John Bernthal, because John Bernthal is in a very small role in that movie.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Sicario is just a phenomenal movie. And again, watch it if you haven't watched it. And it hurts me that Sicario 2 didn't deliver on what it could have been. But when I look at Josh Brolin, when I look at Benicio Del Toro, those two characters in that movie... They weren't playing bad guys, but they scared me so much in that movie because you never knew what to expect from them, and especially from Benicio, that scene at the dinner table. If you've seen it, you know what we're talking about. It's one of a kind that year. It's in a league of its own that year.
It's the whole setup. The setup with the cop in the beginning.
Yeah.
The father played with the father, and you're like, what's this got to do with the story? And then you got
Agent Sitwell from, you know, from Avengers.
Emily Blunt's character goes into that house full of dead bodies.
Yeah.
And then she saves one of her partners and it's just very brutal.
And then the explosions that go, like, it just, those are jump scares that are such earned jump scares because it makes you generally fearful of anything that happens.
Things that actually happen. Yeah. Like,
it feels real. So
when they go to Mexico and you see the hanging bodies
and the cartel presence, like,
welcome to Juarez.
And the movie also uses CGI very, very well. Like,
yeah, you can't even tell.
Like that, the shots of pretty much those, you know, all the trucks or the vans kind of going.
Yeah.
It's all CG. Yeah. The body's hanging, and I think about the moments in that film that are so good and so subtle. Like when they're about to interrogate the brother in the room, and you don't know what Benicio's character is doing, but he's just talking to this lawyer, and he's just holding a jug of water.
He's thirsty, man.
Yeah.
But you don't know he's holding it. You just kind of know he's holding it. And it just cuts to him walking with this giant jug of water, and he gets in the room with Josh Brolin's character. He's like, what happened, man? And no hablas inglés, right?
Yeah.
And then just him getting in his face and just like him just, oh man, what a movie.
Even the end, when he says to her, you'll never understand, you know, why we do this. You're never going to be a wolf.
Yeah. Yeah.
She was like, yeah, she's never going to be a wolf. Like, you have to get into a certain mindset to get to, you know, understand what you need to do to take care of these people.
And then we got Sicario 2, which, so you want to be a Sicario.
Yeah. Which, I mean, I don't, let's never talk about that film.
That was actually the first movie we reviewed for This Time With. As This Time With was Sicario 2. Day of the Soldado.
Do you have another film for 2015, though?
2015.
There's a lot of them,
there's, again, yeah. 2015 was a strong year. I loved The Martian that year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
A Force Awakens.
Yeah.
Rogue Nation, Mission Impossible, of course.
Mad Max Fury Road.
Mad Max.
Like, that's good. That was, like, very close to my number one.
Yeah, it was a phenomenal movie.
I don't doubt it.
It was. That was Best Picture of the year. What was Best Picture of the year?
It was Spotlight.
Spotlight one, yeah.
Which, understandably, because of the topic,
yeah, Spotlight,
Best Picture of the year was Mad Max. But it's not,
yeah.
It wasn't Best Picture, though. It was good movie.
I also love that year. Creed was probably my runner-up for Best Picture that year for me. But it's also a phenomenal year because we got Steve Jobs and we got Straight Outta Compton, which are also phenomenal movies.
Great
that
films.
are in my rotation still to this day, right?
Yeah. So,
how about you, Shay? Would you have any other?
You guys pretty much shouted out most of them here. I'm going to throw it out to Jurassic World as well because we got a very nice revival of the franchise. We got, you know, Chris Pratt. We got Bryce Dallas Howard. And it was just a fun time at the theater.
Yep.
And I really, really liked Inside Out.
Oh, yeah. Beautiful movie. Absolutely beautiful movie.
I think
movie.
It was the last of that Pixar, you know, emotional connection, human connection film until I think most recently when we have this new
Soul
coming out.
Which is the same director too, right? Yeah. We have Pete Docter coming back for that. So, yeah.
That was the last original film, right? Before all the sequels that came out.
We had a lot of sequels that followed, but it looks like Pixar is going back to their kind of roots now. But yeah, 2015, like we had a... We've been lucky that we've been having a lot, like a good string of years, those years. That I think that's why these more recent years have been feeling a little bit more empty is because we've had such bangers one after another.
Mm-hmm.
Well, how about 2016, guys?
What's 2016?
What is 2016? 2016,
Moonlight for me.
Moonlight was a great movie.
It was very good. When I went to watch it at TIFF, I watched it at the world premiere.
Nice.
Was
Mahershala Ali there?
Yes, Mahershala was there. Barry Jenkins was there. The whole cast was there. Naomi Harris was there.
Were both Chirons there?
All three Chirons?
Yes. I don't even the kid. Yes. Nice. Yes. I remember watching it and I didn't know what to expect.
Yeah.
I didn't know. I remember watching the trailer and I'm like, people were talking about this film being like, oh, this is something that you should go watch at TIFF. So I did get tickets. No one, to tell you the truth, it wasn't hard to get.
No,
Moonlight was not a movie
that it went spotlight.
Yeah, it went under the radar.
Yeah,
and I got really good seats, very close to the stage. And man, what a crazy film!
And when you think about like they were saying like the scenes in the water when they were like, yeah, they only had like 10 minutes to shoot it.
Yeah,
like the whole movie I think was shot in what like 2 weeks or something like that.
Because I think it was Nightmare's schedule as well.
Yeah, so like it's such a beautiful movie and like. Every time I think of Moonlight, I always think of our friend Kadeem, who passed away this year.
Mm-hmm.
Just because him and I would always talk about it. Yeah. Like we would always talk about it with him. And it just always reminds me of him and him
it does,
tweeting about
too,
it. You know, it just always brings
his
him
love
to
for
mind.
That film was amazing. Yeah. And it's one of the things that kind of pushed me to watch it. I remember we watched it together.
That's a great movie. Yeah.
Yep.
Again, connected to Moonlight for. Bad reasons, but La La Land is a movie that stands out to me in 2016.
La La Land. That's another
beautiful movie. Damien Chazelle. Yeah. I think that's my favorite film of 2016, mm-hmm. I would say. But honorable mention, I'll throw out like Doctor Strange, The Nice Guys. I think I want... I'm blanking on his name right now. Shane Black. So much to do with sequel to it or...
Or Kiss Kiss Bang Bang.
Or just something. Go back to his roots because I think his studio films haven't been as strong as... His going with his own vision of things, you know.
Almost, right?
But I think my favorite movie in 2016 will definitely be La La Land.
Yeah.
La
La Land was also mine, and the reason why I give it to La La Land is I love Hollywood. I love old Hollywood, especially. Yeah. But I don't like musicals, and for me to like this film, it had to overcome a lot.
Right.
It had to be catchy. It had to be interested, and I love Ryan Gosling, and I just loved the music, but. There were also, Civil War that year as
Civil War, Rogue One.
Another one that stood out to me a lot was Arrival.
Oh, my God.
I really enjoyed Arrival. Yeah. And I love Denis, and I love what he was trying to do with the film. And it was...
Denis crazy. So, back-to-back-to-back back years, right?
Right? And it's just, yeah. But obviously, Nice Guys really loved that as well. The same year that we got Nocturnal Animals, which was my favorite film of that year.
Oh, my God. How is that on this list
Nocturnal
right now?
Animals... Tom Ford.
Yeah, that's a theater experience too. You don't forget.
I'll never forget that movie. Mm-hmm.
And you know what? I'll throw it out there as well too, just because we throw haven't it out yet. There. 2016, it got a lot of hate, but I think the ultimate edition of Batman vs. Superman, mm-hmm. there's some really great stuff in there.
Again, I enjoy a lot of aspects of that film.
Yeah.
I get people hate it, but I think it's also, I think it's too hated. I think
that's too, it's too the fun hated. Movie to hate, right?
It's like, okay, let's take it easy.
It's easy to pick on, which yeah. Unfortunately. But going on to 2017, I think this is where my lists have been getting shorter and shorter. Literally for every year, and then we start getting into 2017, and it's like the lists are a lot shorter of what we're looking at. But what was your top films of 2017, Anthony?
I'm so sorry. Give me one second.
No worries. I could go if you want me to go.
No, because you might steal mine.
Okay.
Where is it
here? Thank God I had a list in my notes of my
2017. Okay, no, you can go.
I think for my favorite movie of 2017, I'm going to give it to Dunkirk. Again... movie by Christopher Nolan, my favorite director working today. A war movie. Love war movies. Love World War II. And this movie, the way that it takes place, land, sea, and air, and even the timelines of them are different amongst them, but still tell a story with a through line. I think the only director who could handle making something so complicated, mm-hmm. easy to follow is Nolan. And I think that's why it's my favorite movie of the year. But shout out to Blade Runner 2049, which I absolutely adored that year. Again, Denis, I don't know how he's had, literally since 2014, back-to-back-to-back-to-back hits. That's like 4 years.
Did he have one this year? No, he didn't have one this year.
He didn't have any movies. He's working on Dune. But like 2014, 2015, 16, and 17, he had like phenomenal movies. That's unreal. And Wind River as well, too, is a movie that I really loved from 2017.
Yeah,
but yeah, how about you, Anthony?
Logan.
Yeah, Logan was my runner-up as well, too.
Yeah, Logan was the end of the Hugh Jackman Wolverine.
Mm-hmm.
Going into it, it was just like you thought it was going to be Old Man Logan, which it was, but it had a different take on it. And I thought it was probably Hugh Jackman's best performance as Wolverine. Phenomenal movie.
That opening sequence set on the limo.
Yeah, the limo scene.
Really, like, set the tone.
Set the tone, set the rating. And again, that was the first superhero movie that we really saw get the R rating.
Yeah.
Yep.
Or Deadpool came out in 2016, right?
Yes, but it was really like, okay, they're taking it serious.
Yeah, and it was
a serious comic book film.
And then, like, what Shay mentioned, like, James Mangold's just brought such... And that's why I get vibes of Mangold, like, in The Mandalorian right now, just because it's, like, that Western, old, like, just grittiness that, like, works so well for some characters, and to see a proper Wolverine story.
Yeah, without the spandex.
Yeah, with Diane... what's her name?
The cigars and the...
Hey, the bub!
Yeah, it was very serious tone to it.
Yeah.
The whole sequence...
Daphne Keene. Who plays X-23.
Yeah.
That scene where she doesn't talk the whole movie, then the scene in the car where she just goes off on him in Spanish, and he's just like, "What's happening?" Right, like that's like amazing scene. What a scene.
So good,
a beautiful, beautiful film.
It had a lot riding on its shoulders, and I think it delivered in every way possible.
Mm-hmm.
Also, the year that we got Get Out,
okay,
and Split as well too, right?
Yeah, you're right. Wonder Woman came out that year too.
Wonder Woman as well.
For me, again, this was a tough year because as there were a lot of films that were great, but as you're saying it, Daniel, that the list gets harder to really pick that one.
Right.
So for me, the obvious choice here was Justice League by Zack Snyder's cut, obviously.
Oh, Justice League, as the people like to call it on the internet.
I want
to
see the Zack Snyder version. What's it called again? Snyder Cut?
Snyder Cut.
Yeah.
The Snyder Cut.
It's never coming.
No.
Anyways, no, for me, and it's one that... It's not going to be a surprise to people because they know I talk about this film a lot. And it's only reason why it's up there is because, to me, representation is one of those things that's very interesting.
Yeah.
I don't see people that look like me on screen. So when I saw this film, I was very intrigued by it. But I also just really liked it because it's really funny. And it's To the Big Sick. I remember you and I went to go watch that in Varsity.
Yeah.
And just loved it. Like, we had such a good time with that movie. No?
Yeah.
You look a little upset about it.
No, I'm looking at my... I was trying to make a joke about 2017 and movies.
Yeah.
And then I was looking at my list.
It's the Emoji Movie, of course.
Yeah, it was the Emoji Movie,
right?
That was
the movie of the year. But I also really liked Call Me By Your Name, and I remember I watched that, and I love the performances. That was what introduced me to the to our golden god, Timothée Chalamet.
Yeah, I mean...
That was 2017?
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, into like his own starring role, because we've seen him in like Interstellar and
but
stuff.
But really, like, roles, that was like when I got to know.
That's when Chalamet became. That's when he became on the scene.
Swiss Chalamet almost.
Yeah, The Big Sick is a movie that I've watched a bunch of times since it's been out on release, and it's such a well made movie, and I just Kumail Nanjiani and I'm blanking on
Zoe Kazan.
Is that his wife's name?
Well, no, that's the actress's name.
No, but who's
Emily Gordon?
Emily Gordon, that's it, who wrote the movie. It's such a... I love the fact that they're like, this is a real story. Let's tell our story, because it's a unique story.
Yeah.
And it's just so well told. And I just... Yeah, it's such a good movie. It's so funny, but it's also not afraid to be dramatic. And I wish it got the more recognition that it deserved at award shows. But I think it was also one of those movies that really started... movements for things to change, right?
I think it did too.
Yeah, so it's one of those,
because you're seeing like, oh, it's straight to Amazon.
Yeah, right? but it got
straight to theater.
They were nominated for an Oscar for it, because we were surprised there was no Golden Globe nomination, but they did get the Oscar nomination. We're like, oh my god, we're starting to see the change,
right? Yeah.
Of things happening, right? Yeah,
yeah.
Phenomenal movie.
It's a good movie.
You should watch it, man. It's really good, really, really good.
It's really funny, and Ray Romano does a great job, and so does
Deborah.
No, what's his wife's name? Oh my god, she's in Batman vs Superman. She plays Mrs.
Holly Hunter.
Holly Hunter?
Yes.
It is Holly Hunter.
Incredible.
Oh, Elastigirl. Yeah, Holly Hunter. Yeah.
Holly Hunter. Yeah, she does a phenomenal job.
She's
film
great
too.
In it. She's phenomenal.
And it's just got a lot of these cameos that kind of work. Like you have who directed Eighth Grade again? Bo Burnham.
Yeah. Amy Bryant is in as well. Oh, it's like from like if you're a comedy fan, you'll see people that you know in that.
Yeah.
How about for 2018, Anthony? Now we're coming up closer to.
Yeah.
We're getting closer.
There's
and
a
closer.
Lot of movies.
Okay.
A lot of movies. You might think I'm going to pick one movie over the other movie, but I'm not.
Are you going to throw us for a curveball here?
Yeah. Tell us.
Venom.
Okay, so what's your film choice? I swear to God.
Whoever's just checked their looked at their phone.
Isles of Dog.
Isle of Dogs?
Is it? Yeah, sorry. Isle of Dogs. Not Isles of Dogs.
Isle of Dog?
Isle 3 and Isle 4.
Isle of Dogs.
Isle of Dogs. Well, another Wes Anderson movie.
Another Wes Anderson. Listed. This one, very similar to Fantastic Mr. Fox, which, when did that come out?
2009.
Yeah. Claymation, beautiful story about dogs. Yeah, love it. I just loved it. I loved everything about it. I loved the Japanese undertone to it. I love the
well, it takes place in Japan, didn't it?
Yes. Forgot. Yes.
The Japanese overtone of it.
Beautiful the Japanese movie, yeah. Inspiration. To
inspiration.
It.
Yeah.
Bryan
Cranston is a voice of a dog. It's great.
Yeah.
Jeff phenomenal. Goldblum
Jeff Goldblum.
Ed Norton. Everyone.
Anyone who was in Grand Budapest is in this movie.
Yeah, that sushi scene to me still is like one of the most memorable moments in that film, because I was like, wow, this is so well done.
Yeah.
I
mean,
the amount of animation that had to go to it, the stop motion animation, phenomenal.
I'm so surprised. Wes Anderson is one of those directors that I'm so surprised we haven't seen him be like, oh, Netflix is giving him $10 million to make movies. You know, because
he's so under the radar, but still... on the
so
radar.
Known, but like, yeah, but he's
like top five directors right now.
Yeah, but he's one of those directors that
he hasn't made a miss.
No, he hasn't made a bad movie. Yet.
Maybe Moonlight, Moonrise
Kingdom was one of my favorites of his, though.
Yeah,
which is like, odd because I love that movie. Yeah. I don't know.
I love that movie too, but I guess that's his weakest in the past couple.
Maybe.
But yeah,
like Aquatic is gone.
I like that. I like that.
Good choice. Solid choice.
2018.
I'll give you guys whoever gets it.
I know. I think Daniel's going to take it.
Yeah.
And that's fine because I didn't put it on purpose. Unless it's not what I think it is, then.
I feel like you think I'm going to say Mission Impossible Fallout.
No.
Okay, yeah, I did. But now
I'm
you're
going to
take what mine is. You're going to take what mine is, aren't you? You sick son.
Yours is Spider-Man to the Spider-Verse.
It is.
Wow. You guys are throwing a curveball because I thought it was something else.
Did you think I was going to say Avengers Infinity War?
Yes. What the fuck's wrong with you guys?
I'm just reading all of your minds right now.
You're saying Spider-Man?
So...
You thought we were going to say Avengers Infinity War.
Yeah, because you guys were like just loving it. You went to watch it like 900 times.
That is when I look at my top three films of that year, it's Mission Impossible, Fallout, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, and Avengers Infinity War. All phenomenal movies. The reason why I want to talk about Fallout.
Okay, I was like, what do you want to talk about?
Yeah, because I know Shade's going to talk about Spider-Verse, and we've spoken about Spider-Verse so much, but Fallout is one of those movies that, again, I don't understand how the Mission Impossible films keep getting better, and Henry Cavill in that movie is phenomenal. And again, as people who like him as Superman, seeing him get a good role is nice to see, but just that movie in itself is just so mind-blowingly shot, and just set piece after set piece just blows me away, and then Tom Cruise is so committed. I absolutely love it, and it's one of those movies that makes me fall in love with movies. Just because going to the theater and watching it, you're just like, this is what a movie can be. And I feel the same way with Spider-Verse, but I'll let Shay talk about that more because, again, I probably watched that the most. That's probably the most watched movie I have of 2018 after Infinity War.
2018 was definitely, it was a tough one to pick as well because, yeah, I mean, as easy as I could give it to Avengers Infinity War, as much as I love Marvel movies and comic book films, I think really Avengers, the first one, that kind of says it all. If I say I liked Avengers,
that's the proof of the.
That's
the,
it. The you proof know what? Of the rest of them is not just me being repetitive by saying I like them right. too. There's a lot of films this year that I really liked, and I am going to talk about Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, but I definitely want to give some shout-outs to A Quiet Place.
Yeah, 100%. Again, that's like number four on my list now.
I want to give a huge shout-out to Hereditary. Absolutely. When I first watched it, I was like, nah, I don't know what the hell I did, but it stayed in my mind. And I really like that. And obviously Fallout, because exactly what Daniel said there. But I also really enjoyed Crazy Rich Asians that year, too.
Great movie. Really big surprise.
Big surprise. Game Night as well was another big surprise.
Yep.
But Spider-Verse to me was amazing because it, again, had so much writing against it. And it was such an amazing Spider-Man movie. And the animation to me was so innovative. It's something that you still haven't seen.
It's something as small, like you don't notice, like when you see him, when you see Miles at the beginning of the movie as Spider-Man. You're like
pause and watch it almost.
Yeah, you're just like, you're watching it, you're like, well, he doesn't feel like, aside from him not being Spider-Man yet,
right.
Visually he doesn't feel like it. And then you, like inside baseball, like knowledge of it, it's like, it's because they animated him at 12 frames a second instead of 24 frames per second. So,
and then when he starts to,
when he starts to become Spider-Man more, the frame rate of how he's being animated is higher, so he looks smoother in his movements and stuff. So it's like little microcosmic details like that that just take Spider-Verse to the next level. And I'm so happy that it just got announced a sequel as well too.
Yes,
wow, yeah, great movie. But yeah, 2018 was there some really good ones.
In that one, you know.
We've made it to 2019, so this is the end of the decade. So obviously, we're going to have an episode of our top films of the year later on this year.
Mm-hmm. But the answers might change.
Answers may definitely change. We're recording this on November 16th right now. So there's still a lot of movies left to go. A
lot of films.
But I'll let Anthony give his movie defining of this year so far.
I know what it's going to be.
What is it going to be?
Just say it and I'll be like, yes.
you're going to be
No, I'll be truthful with you if you say if I'm wrong.
It's Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Okay, I was wrong.
Okay, cool. It is. I love that film.
That's amazing. I'm glad for you.
Hate it?
No, I don't hate it.
You just didn't like
it. The second time I saw it, it grew on me a lot more. Yeah. And I'm really looking forward to watching it at home.
Yeah, I want to watch it at home. Can't wait.
Excited. What about did you like so much?
It's going back to it and understanding like the characters and where they come from and the backstories. And,
and just hanging out with them.
And and then the end sequence, which is crazy.
Oh yeah.
I just love the whole story of this actor who can't get anywhere anymore and has to go into Westerns and find a career there, and his sidekick buddy who is just going on for the ride with him.
Yeah.
And then all the other stuff that happens with the
Sharon
Tate.
There's so much in that movie.
So much. And I just love it. I love it. It's L.A. again, so I'm falling
in love with Hollywood,
old Hollywood specifically. I thought how he was able to capture Los Angeles in that time period, the costumes, art direction, colors.
Yeah. It's beautiful.
Everything on point.
And again, it's a movie that when I first saw it, I'm like, yeah, I wish I liked this more. And then when I saw it the second time, I'm like, wow, I've thought about this movie so much and I keep thinking about it. And I'm glad that it's resonated with me a lot more. And again, I'm just excited to watch it again. Yeah. For 29,
all the deleted scenes.
All the deleted scenes and everything coming from it, I'm down for it.
What did you think I was going to say?
Nothing. We'll get to it.
You don't know me.
For me, I mean, this year has really began underwhelming. And then I think once it kicked in, especially like our TIFF voyage really gave us like banger, banger, banger after another. And we've been on a pretty good streak, you know, with the exception of a couple this year. I mean, Parasite is really fresh on my mind right now, and it's easily one of the top films this year. And I know it feels like a cop-out to say this, but I think what Avengers Endgame accomplished this year in terms of bringing that chapter of the MCU to a close and
wrapping things up
and giving fan service, but also still making a coherent movie with time travel and stakes and drama and action and comedy. It's a movie that if we thought the first Avengers seems so simple now, when you compare it to what we've gotten since then, right? Mm. And I think Endgame is a movie that just that portal scene alone. I've watched it a couple times on Disney Plus because it's in 4K and Dolby Vision and all that, and just like watching it and just watching that end sequence and thinking back to when I first saw Iron Man and seeing Nick Fury at the end and being like, oh, they're going to start making the Avengers, and seeing what the MCU has become since then and where it's going. Mm-hmm. It makes me so happy as a fan. And I love it. Mm-hmm. I absolutely love it. So I think I'm going to say Endgame for mine, but again, we'll see where the end of the year stacks, right?
That's a very, very, very solid choice.
Yeah. How about you, Shay?
This one was also, again, I remember we discussed this a lot. This year was very rough in the beginning. It really picked up, especially with TIFF. And if I hadn't just seen this movie, I would have given it to Midsommar this year because I loved Midsommar so much. It was so engrossing and it made me upset and it gave me a lot of reactions. But I know this might be a hop-out as an answer as well because we just saw it, but Parasite. I think Parasite to me, it did so much by doing what it needed to do.
Right.
It kept the conversation moving. It never let me predict what was going to happen next.
No, you never knew what was
going to go. I never knew what was going to happen.
And I think, again, with the exception of Endgame being the monster at the box office that it was, the film that I'm seeing the most discussion about online is Parasite.
Easily.
And that's amazing for a movie that is, one, not made here.
No.
You know what I mean? And two, something that isn't playing everywhere, but people are actively seeking it out.
Yeah.
And I think that's what's so special about Parasite is that people are actively seeking out to go watch it and experience it so they could talk about it with people
that also don't normally go watch films. I've noticed that as a trend that it's people that I've talked to that don't go watch movies that often. They're like, no, I keep hearing about this Parasite film. I got to go watch
it.
And if you're listening to this podcast right now and you haven't seen Parasite,
Go watch it.
And it's playing so many more places now. So we had to like go for a little trek to find ours, but it's playing in a lot of local cinemas now. So definitely go watch it. And when you think of what this year has given us, it's given us the biggest blockbuster film of all time. And it's given us smaller movies. And like when I look at also this year with Honey Boy and Ford versus Ferrari and Joker,
Irishman
and Sound of Metal, Jojo Rabbit, like this second half of 2019 has been giving us some real great movies. And I'm so curious to see what award season is going to look like next year because, like, who knows? Like, I feel like it's just so up in the air.
There's a lot of randoms that will be thrown in.
You know what I mean?
And what's interesting to me is I'm hoping at least this Oscar year we're going to see some real like movies that we really know.
Yeah, really like, and that's how I kind of felt with Spider-Verse last year. Yeah, it's a Sony movie. Yeah, it's a Spider-Man movie, but Spider-Verse was the underdog last year.
Easily.
And it's like it's nice when you see movies that deserve the recognition, get that recognition. The one thing that's for sure though, like you know, we started this podcast back in February. We really started every week in March.
Right. March was the big one.
With March was when we were consistent with our episodes and everything. And it's, I don't think there's ever been a better time to talk about movies than what we're doing right now. And yeah, it's just great to be able to when you think of 2010 doesn't feel almost 10 years ago.
No.
It feels like a few years ago. You know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. I feel like your internal clock kind of stops sometimes. You're like, yeah, Inception was only a few years ago. But like, no, next summer it's going to be 10 years old.
Yeah.
When we're watching Tenet, we're like, well, remember Inception 10 years ago? Oh, like, that's crazy to think. But this has been a really good decade of movies.
Yeah.
How do you think this decade compares to the 90s or the 2000s or years before that? Because I think if we're just looking at what the year 2000 and forward has given us, I think the 2010s are stronger than 2000 to 2009.
And I think the reason why is this is now where Hollywood is trying to take it seriously as a business and not so much that, hey, we know people are going to come to watch the movie. Now they have to get us in the seats.
Right.
That wasn't a problem before because really what do people do? They go to the movies.
Right.
Now people can watch movies at home. Pirating is so much easier. You can do Netflix.
Right.
There's other activities out there. So how are you gonna draw us to your movie?
Right.
Make it compelling. And that's what they're trying to do now. They're trying to take it a lot more seriously. I think now, especially starting this year, we really are starting to see those original movies, those smaller indie films make that splash.
Yeah. And just like with indie movies now, like I think they're bigger than ever.
Yeah.
Like indie movies are such a driving force of Hollywood now, and even though it doesn't feel like it, because like you make one indie movie now and it feels like your next picture is like you're getting a deal from Marvel's calling you. Netflix is calling you, and I think that's when you see the success of Marvel. All of their movies, like all of the more recent movies, have been from indie directors getting like the call. Like they're calling, like they're the farm team getting called up to the big leagues now, right. You know? Yeah. And I feel like indie movies are so important now. And I think just going forward, I'm so excited to see what 2020 is going to bring. Cause there's some big movies coming next year too,
big year.
Yeah. So that was our top films of the decade. It feels so weird saying that. It still feels weird saying that.
I didn't realize it was like the end of the decade until
you just said it.
Until I was like, oh yeah,
wait, it's 2019. About, Daniel, 20, like,
yeah.
Damn. I just didn't think of it.
Now, of course,
I know you said it was like trending, so
yeah,
it's
we've been seeing a lot of people put publishing their own list. I'm like, yeah. Oh yeah, in that movie.
Man, 10 years passed.
10 years already. Again, this episode is a pre-recorded episode as you're listening to it, as all of our shows are, but we're not here this week.
That's haven't done a live episode yet.
That's why we haven't asked for your movies of the decade, but please write into the show, thistimewith.com/talk. Let us know what some of your favorite movies of the decades are, and we'll read them on our next show once we return from Orlando. Do you guys have
a movie of the decade?
A movie of the decade. 2010 till now?
Yeah.
Ooh. Woo!
It's hard.
That's too hard. I can't think of that right now.
No, it's okay.
Well, we'll come back with our next episode with our movie of the decade picked.
Ooh. All right. Sounds good.
Yeah, so we have homework to do, guys.
So again, write us in at thistimewith.com/talk. Let us know what your movie of the decade is, or movies of the decade, or movies that maybe you didn't agree with us on. We'd love to hear what you guys have to say.
That was This Time with the Movie Podcast.
And we'll see you next.